I'd like to move on now, please, to the item 8 on the agenda, which is the governance manual. And Karen, you might wish to introduce it for us.
Yes, hopefully this won't necessarily take too long, but another piece of important work we've been doing with the Audit and Risk Committee through the year is looking at the extent to which we've properly embedded in our organisation the way that we manage, control and assure the work of NHS England. And we're now 3 years in, obviously, to our existence, and we agreed during the course of the last year that we needed to move faster on making sure that we had embedded appropriate controls and assurance. One part of that work is the governance work, and what this represents is trying to implement a way of better managing in a systematic way all of our governance work across the organisation. So the manual is the way of doing that. We've taken the opportunity, of course, as well to update our standing orders, SFIs and delegations to reflect changes in our management structure, to do some tidying up which needed to be reflected, and to streamline some aspects of the way that we operate so that it makes it easier for the organisation. So this paper is just bringing that to your attention, asking for your approval. It has already been gone through by the Audit and Risk Committee, so I think you can be assured that this is acceptable to approve.
David, I assume that you endorse that last comment.
Well, we do.
Good. Everybody's had a copy of the revised papers with track changes. I'm sure everybody's read it. Actually, there are some very, I love this sort of thing, but there's some really interesting stuff in there. But on the assurance that we've had from Karen and from David, may I ask the board please to approve it? Thank you very much. Item 9 on the agenda is the revised patient complaints policy.
Yes. This, again, reflects some work that we've been doing. It's not a substantive change, but it's obviously important that it comes to the board for approval. I chair a customer contact and complaints programme board on behalf of NHS England, and we constantly are looking at our performance on contact and dealing with complaints across the organisation, both centrally and in our regions. And as part of that work, we have identified that some of the issues that are getting in the way of prompt response to complaints is a limited number of people who are able to sign off complaint letters. And we've expanded that number with our regions to hopefully unlock that bottleneck and improve our general performance. So those changes have been reflected in the policy. We've also done some further tidying up and also to reflect some quality assurance work that we've been doing on the way that we manage and improve complaints and assurance. There's a lot more work to be done. I'm sure we'll be coming back with more changes, but again, I think you can be assured that these are sensible improvements to make to the way that we manage our complaints.
Thank you, Sharon. Any comments on that? Bruce.
Karen, can I just ask you about the sort of quality of the response? So over the years, I've watched or read numbers of letters from different NHS organisations which are sent to patients, which if they were angry before they'd sent the complaint in, they would have been incandescent when they got the response. And it's a lot of it's a bit just about language, about saying sorry and simple things like that. Do we have a quality control that ensures these letters are A, proportionate in their language, and that they're easy to read and easy to understand, and not just some kind of bureaucratic diatribe which arrives on someone's desk? And I've seen plenty of those.
I'm sure, Bruce, we can always do better on this, and I see them myself as well. We certainly do have a quality assurance process and a quality assurance framework. We are doing more work to try to
extend some training and best practice across the people who deal with the complaints. And we have a proper quality assurance process over the letters that go out. But I have no doubt that we can improve that.
Yeah, they need to be kind.
They do. They need to be appropriately apologetic. And they also need to be clear and simple to understand. It's often a balance between trying to unpick a complex complaint and address every issue in it and in very simple, plain English. And that can sometimes look bureaucratic. I know exactly what you're thinking of, but we are doing our best.
Thank you. Do we get feedback on people's experience of complaining as opposed to just getting the letter? And do we segment that by population in any way? Do we know who complains most and where?
We are now at the point where we can start to mine our information about complaints, because we have last year implemented a contact system so that every complaint and every contact is recorded systematically, and we've now got good information that we can start to mine. So we are starting to do that and to work out what we are learning from our complaints. We also do surveys. We try to get feedback from people who have complained. That's actually quite hard to get that feedback. But we are constantly thinking about how we can do that. But I'm very happy to bring back information to you and the board about what we learn from that as we do. This is starting to be available to us now to really investigate.
John, my question is essentially the same one. I mean, increasingly now, especially if we use mobile phones and so on, people can be asked, you know, just by text, how did you feel about the response? And I think it would be instructive to know, to actually address the issue that Bruce is raising.
That's exactly the sort of thing that we're anxious to try and put in place, to try and get, you know, TripAdvisor type feedback, you know.
How did I do?
Was this okay for you? Clearly, the one piece of evidence we have, which you won't be surprised at, is the experience that people talk about is most closely related to the outcome. So if they got a good outcome, they're more likely to be happy. If they got an outcome which they're not happy with, however well handled it was, they tend not to be happy with that. But apart from that, we are doing our best to try and improve that.
A good outcome, but you waited 6 months to get it. I mean, I've been very taken talking to people in our complaints teams that how ready they are to pick up the phone straight away, discuss it informally with the complainant, and actually often head off what might be a growing sense of injustice by personal informal responses in early stage.
I think you're absolutely right, Madam. That's been a really important point that we've been trying to get to, which is dealing with as many of these complaints and issues at the first point of contact and training up our first tier of response so that they are able to do that. And I think that has a big impact, obviously. But many of these are more complex and take longer to deal with.
But even with the complex one, having that first point of personal contact is a very good way of managing the process thereafter. Thank you very much. So are we content to endorse the revised policy? Thank you very much.